All right.
Let's go get started. We got quite a bit to do today.
As you recall, last week I talked about data conditioning and introduced a project. And I also talked about data, the basic biomechanical modeling. What I want to do today is talk about what happens when all you have is coordinate data for a single frame. So you have a single frame where you have coordinate data for the xy position of the wrist, xy position of the elbow, xy position of the shoulder, xy hip, xy knee, xy ankle. Okay? And you know the load, you know the weight of the subject, and you know the height of the subject. And that's all. I want to add a little bit more depth to the problem that you would actually see if you were using motion measurement data. So, before I, and then after we do an example of this, I want to talk about the project a little bit more and at least get started on work physiology, on applied physiology today. If not, I'll finish it next week and we can go over the problems during the review session, the Monday afterwards, because two weeks from today's exam, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. Questions first. Yes.
Give me possible practice problems you can upload to Canvas. That way we can get
it. They're already there. If you look at the practice problem set for exam two, there's several biomechanics problems and also there's work physiology problems.
Okay. I was wondering also if you had any others just outside the exam, you could maybe do that. Because the bigger variety we have, the better prepared we are.
Mm-hmm. So. I agree. So I'll be doing at least two problems today, and each problem takes about a half an hour. So we're doing two of those today. And then next week, depending on how far I get with physiology, we do some of those as well.
Okay, thanks, Matt.
Okay, so, like I said, the data that you will have are the XY coordinates. The height of the individual, weight, subject, that way, height and weight of subject, and also the load, if there is any. So that means that we have to make some sort of inferences about the segment lengths as a proportion of body of height. Okay? This is an average segment distribution. This particular illustration, this table. This means that your hand is 0.108 times your height. Your forearm from the elbow to the wrist is 0.146 times height. Your upper arm from the shoulder to the elbow 0.186 times height, and if we want to get the head and trunk by subtraction, you need to subtract this 0.818 to the shoulder from 0.530 to the hip from the 0.818 from the shoulder. That gives us the head and trunk from the shoulders down to the hip. Okay. These are all proportions of body height, or a proportion of subject height. Okay. So, if I want to know, if I have a subject that is let's just say, height of 150 centimeters, it's a lot easier to deal with symmetric, like I said. And I'll do a weight of, 60 kilograms. That's actually mass. Correct that, subject mass, 60 kilograms. And I want to know what the forearm and hand, in other words, from the elbow all the way to the tip of the fingers, you can add these, 0.146 plus 0.108. Okay? So the proportion is 0.146 plus 0.108. Sorry?
0.254.
Yeah, 0.254. And if I want to know the forearm and hand length, it's 0.254 times the height, 150 centimeters. And that is, somebody, it's quick on the calculator.
It's 38.1.
38.1 centimeters. So now we know what the forearm and hand length is of this individual on the average. Okay?
Forearm.
Or if I want another
thing. When did you get the 0.146 and 0.108 again? Okay, that's my bad.
So how did those get derived? Just is it?
Those are from average anthropometric values.
Okay.
And that's why they're only estimates.
Okay.
So if we should always expect that value in the exam, or?
I give you this table in the exam.
Okay.
Thanks, Max.
So that's how we get segment lengths, is using this table. The next step is how to get center of mass position. So the first table is segment length. The first table is segment length. This table gives you distance from both proximal and distal end of the segment to the center of mass. So it's center of mass position and also segment mass. So what did I say the height was, the weight was 60 kilograms? Or mass is 60 kilograms?
Yeah.
So, let's forearm and hand. And it's defined from the elbow axis to the ulnar styloid. That's the way we define forearm and hand. As a proportion of body weight, it's 0.022. So, the segment mass is 0.022 times body weight, which I said was 60 kilograms, which is 1.32 kilograms mass. And if we want to convert it to force or weight, what do I do?
Times 9.8.
Yeah, 1.32.
So 9.8.
Yeah, 9.8 is fine.
Does that turn into
newtons
then?
Mm-hmm.
So
kilogram newtons? This is meters per second squared.
That's right.
So what's 9.8 times 1.32?
12.936.
It's 12.9, I'll call it newtons.
We always use 9.8.
Yes,
because this is the force pulling us down to Earth.
That's gravitational acceleration.
That's right.
G.
Yeah.
G.
One G. That's right. gravitational acceleration. Okay. Now I want to know what, and let's always use proximal. The proportion, the center of mass position from the proximal end for forearm and hand is 0.682. I erased it. So the center of mass position is 0.682 times the segment length. And I think, wasn't the segment length like 28 or something?
It's like 38.1, I think.
38.1
centimeters
in one arm.
Let's call it 30 centimeters. That's a little bit big. Okay.
30 centimeters.
So what's 0.682 times 30 centimeters?
0.682 times 30.
It's going to be about 16.
.682 times 30 is 20.46.
20?
20.46.
20.5.
Well, 6 times 3 is 18.
Yeah, but then you've added this.
Yeah. Right,
okay.
So it's going to be
okay.
more
I'll,
than
I'll
18.
I'll call it 20.5, that's okay. 20.5 centimeters. So that's the distance to the center of mass from the proximal end of the limb. So what we're going to be interested in is the upper arm, the forearm, and hand, and HAT stands for head, head, and trunk. That's from the greater trochanter, right, to the glenohumeral joint, right here. It's exactly where you guys measured it, right? That's why I picked those out. Don't worry about these. These are references that are in the subscript. Don't worry about those letters. So what you'll be interested in is these proportions of segment weight is a proportion of body weight, or mass, actually, and the proximal, the distance to the center of mass from the proximal end of the segment.
Where did that 30 centimeters, did you say, come from?
I just made it up.
Oh, okay.
This is given.
Okay, so it would be...
Yeah, that's given. That's given. Okay. Proportions is what I'm trying to get across. Okay? So these two tables, the first one gives you segment length as a proportion of body height. The second one gives you segment weight or segment mass as a proportion of body weight, and also the position of the center of mass as a proportion of the segment length. Okay. So now we have the proportion, the position of the center of mass, the segment mass, the segment length, and since all I gave you was body height or body weight and height, now a single frame. Did that get locked?
I don't think
it's
not locked.
Anyway,
that's
whatever.
Oh, it's totally locked. Couldn't get in. Here I am.
That's quite
You're
an
late,
entrance
so
space.
We locked the door.
You don't care how long that you couldn't get in.
That's right. So what we got here, you know, is for a single frame during a sagittal coplanar loop, just one frame, you know what the XY position is for the wrist, elbow, shoulder, hip, knee, and ankle, right? Everybody with me so far? And if I graph it, that's what it looks like. Okay? Good. Make sense?
Yeah, looks like a person.
Voila. It does.
Stick man.
Missing what?
It's missing his head.
Most of us are.
Paying attention. Can you repeat that?
This is a stick figure of the person in one frame of the lift during a sagittal coplanar lift. So if I take one frame out of your data, and then I rearrange it and graph it, that's probably what it would look like.
Okay.
Okay. And this I would give you. I would give you the person's height, person's weight, or mass in kilograms, and I would give you the load, and I would give you this, plus a diagram, just so you can visualize it. That's all you'll get.
So something similar to this.
That's right, something similar to this. That's all you'll get. So from now on, this is what you have to create. All right. You'll have these two tables. These two tables are what you use, right?
Oh, those are the smaller version of the previous tables.
Yeah, those are the smaller version of the previous tables. I just reproduced them so we don't have to flip back and forth.
Yeah.
So the first thing you want to do is we're going to do calculations all the way to the hip. That means we have three segments, forearm and hand, upper arm, head and trunk. I'll call them segment one, segment two, segment three, in that order. So the first thing we want to do is find out the length of each one of those segments. Okay, I'm assuming we have a person who's 168 centimeters tall, right? So, forearm and hand, remember I said it's the 0.146 and 0.108 times 168, so that's 42.7 centimeters. Upper arm length, 168 times 0.186, that's 0.186 right there.
Head and trunk is 168 times 0.288. 0.288 is...
Is that that section that doesn't have the dimension?
That's right, it doesn't. It's...
this part right here.
0.818.
So this
is,
minus that.
Yeah, it's 0.818 minus 0.5.
Okay.
30. Okay.
So we run this in.
And that should equal 0.288. And does it? Check my work, make sure that I didn't not lying to you.
Did you get the 0.818 from this?
Okay. The point, which one?
0.818.
It's this one right here. It's the height from the floor to the shoulder. 0.818.
It's too small.
0.288.
The 0.818 is shoulder to the floor.
Mm-hmm.
The 0.50 is hip to the floor. So that doesn't account for the head, though, correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
However, that's the assumption this is we have no markers on the head.
Yeah. So we use...
We use this length, but then we assume the mass of the head as well.
As well, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, the max, I think it's... Oh.
So it's from here, from
this,
the...
This is 0.630.
So here...
Rusty is here.
I'm sorry.
It's this one, Rusty, look, this one,
yeah,
minus this one.
Yeah, okay, yeah. I think you guessed that. I like to see everyone get so excited.
She's so fun.
Yeah, that's right. So now we have the segment lengths, right? We want to know the distance from the proximal end of each segment to the center of mass of each segment. So that means that we take this table now and use these values. For segment L1, the forearm in hand, we take our 42.7 multiplied by 0.682. Right there. I wish that were in order, but.
And you said we use only the proximal.
Only proximal. For the upper arm, we use this length, 31.2, times 0.436. And for the head and trunk, we use 48.4, that's right here, times 0.626.
Are they normally labeled lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3?
That's just the convention I've used.
Oh, that's the one you...
That's my convention. And it would be to your advantage to use that. That's something I know for myself. I don't know if you get to tell you. So is this so far so good?
Yes.
Yes. And proximal, this is the distance from the hip. Okay. We're just using that as a convention. So the proximal for the head and trunk is the hip. Okay. So now what we've got is the length of each segment and the distance from the proximal end of each segment to the center of mass of that segment. Next thing you want to do is figure out what the mass of each of these segments is, and then what the weight of each of the segments is. Okay? The mass, we take these values times the body weight. Okay, so forearm in hand, 0.022 times our 70 kilogram subject mass, 1.5 kilograms, and that translates into what I will call F1, which is the weight of the forearm in hand. It's just 1.5 kilograms, 9.8 meters per second squared, 15.1 newtons.
So instead of F1, we could have used W.
You can use other ones. I'm trying to use more unified, notation on this than we used in the other ones. But yes, you could. As long as it's something that's understandable, you can use the notation that you're interested in. Upper arm mass, 70 kilograms times 0.028.
2 kilograms. So F2, the weight of the upper arm, is 2 kilograms times 9.8. Head and trunk is 70 times 6.78, 47.5 kilograms. And also always do face validity. Head and trunk, it's a big chunk of your body, right?
Yeah.
So you better be big. Okay, these you expect to be relatively small because it's just small segments. This one you expect to be big, so 47.5 kilograms, that sounds reasonable. And then convert it to newtons, 465.1 newtons. The load, remember this. If I say that this individual, he or she, is lifting a 10 kilogram load, a mass of 10 kilograms, divide it in half, because we're doing a sagittal coplanar lift. We're just calculating half of the body. Right? You can only calculate half of the load, because the other half is being lifted by the other half of your body. We're only calculating half of the weight. Then we get to the end, you can double it.
Is that mentioned anywhere, or are we just assuming it's half?
I didn't say what the weight was, but what the load was, but
it's 10.
Okay. Yeah, I didn't say it before. So we translate that into newtons, and we got 49 newtons. Now we have all the forces. Yes.
And all the prior equations from this slide and the previous slide, take that into account too. They're all halves, or
are you?
No, because. We don't have to half this, because we have two of these, and this is the weight of each of them.
We have one head and trunk.
That's the weight of the head and trunk. Yeah. Okay. But those we don't have to half because they're already there.
So only the load weight is divided by two, correct?
That's right.
Okay, and then in an exam, sorry, this is a two-part question. In an exam, you're not going to divide the weight in half, or you could say an object of the total weight of X.
Well, I mean, you will give us the weight of the load.
I'll give you the weight of the load, and you will have to divide it in half. Yes. Yeah, Jared.
Does that apply to the project, too?
Yes.
Yes. So you should, and that's going something. I'm glad you. That's a perfect segue, because I wanted to talk a little bit more about the project after I did the first example, and that's one of the first things I wanted to point out. It didn't make sense to talk about it last week, but you're exactly right.
So we have to go back to our data and change that.
Let's look at.
Relax.
Okay. Next step is to. This is the forearm and hand. Upper arm, head and trunk. And what I've done is I've taken, now notice the convention that I'm using. L1 is the length of the forearm and hand. Lambda1 is the distance to the center of mass of the forearm and hand. F1 is the weight of the forearm and hand. Okay, so what I've done is I filled in each one of those here. Actually, I didn't have room, I don't think, for head and trunk, but I filled it in for the forearm and hand here and the upper arm there. Next step, in my opinion, and you can do it in other orders, but I think it's easier this way, is to calculate the angles. Because remember, to calculate moments, we have to have angle, right? What do we have? We have the xy coordinates for the wrist, we have the xy coordinates for the elbow, xy coordinates for the shoulder, and xy coordinates for the hip. Do you remember?
So this
Sokotoa. Okay, toa is the part of Sokotoa that we're interested in. That's tangent and theta equals opposite over adjacent. Okay? Now, sorry, Linda, I gotta do this.
It's okay.
So the coordinates will be given, right?
Coordinates will be given. Actually, no, I'm not gonna do that. I'm gonna do it here. Let's just look at the forearm and hand. Okay, this segment right here.
Not the elbow to wrist segment.
Elbow to wrist, yes. Okay, those are the two markers. Okay, the xy coordinates of this is 37.6 and 79.
okay? And you know that's convention. Inside parentheses, coordinates are always x, y. X is first and y is second, right? Everybody familiar with that? It's a convention. And at the elbow, it's 59.5 and 92.8. It doesn't matter what it is. It could be some bizarre unit. But all we need to know is the number. It happens to be centimeters, but all we need to know is that number. Okay. At the elbow, this is our reference, our horizontal reference. This is theta. And we'll call it theta 1 because it's the angle for the first segment. Remember, tangent of theta equals opposite over adjacent. It means theta equals the inverse tangent of opposite over adjacent. And if we're thinking about this, what's opposite?
It's this line here.
It's this line right here. And what is that? It's the difference between the y coordinates. Right? So y coordinate is 92.6.
I thought it was 92.8.
Did I say, no, it is 92.8. If you made that mistake, that would probably be okay.
Yeah, it's not that bad.
Yeah, 92.8. And the y coordinate here is 79. Adjacent is this up here. That's the difference between the x-coordinates. It's 59.5 minus 37.6.
And you could do it the other way, I believe, also, and you get the same answer, as long as you're consistent.
Yeah, that's true, because the negative would cancel out. Yeah. Right, yeah. So, that means that if you go through the calculation, which I did right here, we get 32.4 degrees for your angle. Same process for the angle at the shoulder, same process for the angle at the hip.
So this gives us
I suggest that you use this as a generalized formula to not get yourself in trouble. Theta equals the tangent inverse of y sub n minus 1 over x sub n minus 1. That would probably not get you in trouble. Therefore, this is y2 minus y1, x2 minus x1, y3 minus y2, x3 minus x2. You see what I'm getting at? Yes, James.
Do you mind writing the equation for what the hip would be as well? Because
I will.
It makes sense going up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'll do that in a bit. Questions so far? Is this making sense so far? So now we have segment length, distance to the center of mass from the proximal end of each segment, segment force, segment weight, and also the angle relative to the horizontal for each one of the segments. Okay? That means we're ready to start with our static equations, right? And this is for the, I just couldn't fit it on the other one, it was too busy. But that's the equation for the hidden trunk.
So, question. So for some such things like this, do we have to draw the free wire diagram, or do you give us a free wire diagram for this?
We need to draw it for each segment individually.
But okay, so you're just giving us the coordinates.
Yeah, I'm just giving the coordinates here. Get here.
Are you looking for radians or degrees will work?
You can use whichever you want. I think that degrees are probably a little more intuitive. I would suggest using degrees, but if you give me, just label what it is. If you give me radians, tell me to give me radians. All right. Now let's get started on the static equations. And this is the way I would like you to do them. Start with segment one. So this is segment one. This is forearm and hand. Right? my sine dimension, which I will be using for all of these, happens to look like that, but it doesn't matter. Okay? So my sine convention is going to be like this and clockwise positive direction. Right. Give me your sine convention. So I know what your net positives and your negatives are.
So that's from the moment you're taking the clockwise to be a positive moment?
Correct. Up is positive y. So the left is positive x, so that doesn't really matter for us. We could do it either way, because we don't take x into consideration.
Well, we could have taken the counterclockwise.
I could have done anything I wanted to. That's why I did that. Yeah.
Would you recommend putting for a sine function having the positive x-axis always be towards the load?
The x doesn't matter for us, because I won't be giving you anything that you'll have to resolve into x and y forces. It will always be normal forces for your calculations. If I wanted to be mean, I would have you pulling on a bungee cord at an angle. Okay? But I'm not going to do that. Okay, free body diagram. You gotta get all my colors for this. This is even better than signal detection. I need all my colors.
So the free body diagram, the one you did on the previous slide, that was the whole body, right?
That was the whole body, so it's not a free body diagram. It's just the whole body so that I can demonstrate angles. Okay.
Are they gender neutral?
Yes, they're gender neutral. Okay. See, no, I don't know anything in there that refers to gender. Right? Okay. I'll try to draw this as big as possible so that because my handwriting tends to get a little small. Okay. So let's first put in our theta. Theta 1 is equal to 32.4 degrees. Now let's draw in red, just for fun. Let's draw in red our forces. Okay? This is the force due to the load, F sub L, which the force due to the load was 15.1 newtons, or that was 49 newtons. Center of mass, of course, F1, the weight of the forearm and hand, is equal to 15.1 newtons. And then we have an unknown reactive force at the elbow. So I'll call that F sub E. Like I said, I know I'm using slightly different notation, but I think this is more unified when we're going from segment 1 to segment 2 to segment 3. I think it's more interpretable. Okay, that's our forces. Now, in green, I'm going to do the moments. Remember, if we think that this is our pin center joint, we pull on this, which direction is going to go? It's going to go counterclockwise, right? So, the moment due to the load is counterclockwise. The moment due to the forearm and hand, we'll call that M1. And then the equal and opposite moment, the reactive moment at the elbow. So now I have my forces, I have my moments. The only thing left to put on here is my lengths. I suggest I'll do my lengths in blue. The entire length of the forearm and hand is L1, and that L1 was 42.7 centimeters. And then the distance to the center of mass in the elbow is lambda 1, and that we calculated to be 29.1. Second step, free body diagram, which should include all of that. Forces, moments, angles, lengths. And I know I don't draw straight lines well at all, but you get the idea. Now we begin our equations for static equilibrium. Over here, I'll do forces. Summation of forces in the y direction is equal to zero. Right? So summation of the forces in the y direction is F sub L is negative. F sub 1 is negative, based on my convention. F sub B is positive. And that equals zero. So that means F sub E is equal to F sub L plus F sub 1 equals to 49 plus 15.1 equals 64.1 newtons. All right? That's the reactive force at the elbow. First answer. Now we do our moments. Equations for moments. I'll do those up here. Summations of the moments is equal to zero. Reset it so zero is on this side. By convention, ML is negative. M1 is negative. Reactive moment at the elbow is positive. So I rearrange those. Equals ML plus M1. So that means that I have to do, and these are slightly different than what I've had there, but I just didn't rearrange it there. Okay, I'm rearranging it here. So I have cosine theta 1 for ML times L1 times force of the load. Plus, I'm going to have to put this up so you guys can see that over there. Cosine theta 1 times lambda 1 times F1. So, somebody tell me what cosine of 32.4 is.
Cosine of 32.4?
Just to two decimal places.
0.84.
0.84. Times L1 is 42.7. And this is centimeters. Force of the load is 49, which is newtons. Plus 0.84 times lambda 1, 29.1 centimeters, times the weight of the forearm in hand, 15.1 newtons. And the final answer is the moment at the elbow is 2138.3 newton centimeters. You can leave it at that if you want. I don't care if you leave it to newton centimeters. If you want to convert to newton meters, that's okay. All you have to do is change the decimal point two places, and it's 21.4 newton meters. So it's a torque value.
What's
that?
When you write cos, the circle with the, what is that called? That's,
which one?
The circle with the dash in it.
Theta.
Is that theta 1?
Yes. Yeah, cosine theta 1.
You have these sheets, cosine of.
Okay. This is segment 1.
So the answer you can put in newton centimeters or newton meters.
That's right. So now segment 2. Segment 2 is the upper arm. And this is our horizontal. This is the shoulder. And we have a very almost straight down. And I'm going to exaggerate a little bit. But theta 1, or theta 2, I'm sorry, is 88.9. That's almost 90 degrees. So you're almost like this. It's just a little bit forward of 90 degrees. Right?
So all these arrows are the ones we calculated when we were doing the previous step, when we did the tangent so far. Inverse tangent.
Yes. Yeah. That's right. So let's put our forces and our moments and our lengths down. Okay, forces first. First force is the equal and opposite, I'll call it Fe prime, because it's translated. And then we have F2 at the center of mass, and then the reactive moment at the shoulder. I'll call that F sub S. Okay, we know what Fe prime is because it's the equal and opposite of Fe, which is 64.1 newtons. Mm. We know what the weight of the upper arm is, 19.2 newtons. And force to the shoulder is the unknown. Okay. Now, we have the moment at the elbow and Me prime. Moment at the elbow is clockwise. So Me prime, I'll put it out here, is the equal and opposite of moment at the elbow. We also have this force created by the reactive force, also in counterclockwise, the center of mass moment, and then finally, the reactive moment at the shoulder. Okay, so now we've added a different moment. And let's take a look at our lengths. Maybe I can do a better length on this side. That's L2 is equal to 31.2 centimeters. And lambda 2 is equal to 13.6 centimeters. Everybody diagram. Okay, all the moments and all the lengths, et cetera, et cetera, forces.
Forces, moments, length, and center of mass.
Mm-hmm.
Forces,
moments, and lengths, and angle.
Fine. Forces, length, and angle.
The center of mass is a force, and a length. Yeah. Now, let's write our... We've already got our sign convention, so you only need to give me your sign convention once. We don't have to rewrite the sign convention. Now let's write our equations of static equilibrium. Summation of forces in the y direction is equal to zero. So let's get started. Fe prime, so zero is equal to negative D prime, negative F2, positive Fs. These are easy. Equals F prime plus F2 equals to 64.1 plus 19.2. And that's, it's 84.1 minus 0.6 is 83.3. Okay, 83.3 newtons. That's it for the forces. Now, for the moments, I always do this to myself in that room. I'm going to turn this on. Would it be helpful if I have this on or off?
On for now. Yeah, for now on. Yeah.
On. Sorry.
Yeah. See if I'm
sorry.
It's
okay. So now, we have the summation of moments equal to zero. And so our first moment is ME, which is negative. So we'll say negative Me prime, negative, I forgot to label that one. And what did
an FE prime.
So A prime minus M F doing that. M F E prime minus M two plus M S equals zero. So let's rearrange it so it's neater. We have MS, which is our unknown, equals M E prime plus M F E prime plus M2. So I'll do one per row here because I'm running out of space. M E prime is already known to be 2138.3 Newton centimeters. Okay. Okay. MFE, we don't know. So we have to take cosine of theta 2, and it's plus cosine of theta 2 times the entire length, L2, times FE prime. And MFE prime, M2 is cosine of theta 2, lambda 2 times F2. And if we put the values in for that, which are right here, the result, and only because I'm running out of space, is 2176.7 Newton centimeters. Again, does this have face validity? 76.7 Newton centimeters. Does this have face validity? Well, think about it. If I'm bent slightly forward, I have this at an angle where I'm generating this much torque, but my upper arm is almost straight down. It's only slightly forward. I'm not going to add much torque to at the shoulder because it's almost straight down. So this is 2138.3. This is 2176.7. It's always a slight increase. That has face validity. It's what you'd expect. Okay?
Your equation for your moment, I'm looking through the equation sheets. It's not in there, or
no.
It's not. The expectation is.
The expectation is that you know how to develop them.
Okay.
Based on, this is what's there. Summation of the forces of y is equal to zero, summation of the moments is equal to zero. And because there's so much variability that you have to learn to do this, you have to learn to develop them for each specific problem.
In layman's terms, can you explain the cosine? Because I'm at a loss as to what cosine of beta means.
Jason over half question.
Well, yeah, that doesn't really say anything.
Yep.
If this is zero and this is one, cosine of 0 degrees is one. So it starts here. And it drops to zero at 90 degrees. So this is 90 degrees, this is 0 degrees. Okay. And then it cycles just like the sine does, but it's 90 degrees out of phase with sine.
It's 180.
I'm sorry?
I was gonna say that's just 180.
Yeah, and then it cycles down here to plus, well, this is 180.
No, 180 is negative on the calculator.
Negative. Oh, yeah, right. So this is 180. Sorry.
Yeah,
and this is 275.
270 or 275?
7.
270. See, I told you I'm not very good at doing this math. I never said I was. and then back up. It's a function. Cosine and sine are both functions that have this wave-like shape when you graph them out, and it is a way to resolve the amount of to reduce the amount of force based on the size of the angle. Because these angles are going to be essentially between 0 and 90 degrees. Closer to 90 degrees is closer to no increase, because it doesn't create any torque. Closer to 0 it is, the more torque it is. It translates all of it. Does that help?
The whole second part makes sense. The cosine, I'm still not, I'll have to read some stuff on.
Okay. So basically, what I learned, Professor, back when I did the moments, when I learned, is like they're perpendicular now. If you're taking a moment, you have the force and the length perpendicular. Where then they're not, in this case, you have an angle, then you have to multiply by the cosine or the sine of that angle. But we're not using sine, so we only.
We have to reduce it accordingly.
Yeah.
And we have to reduce it because of the angle, and this is a proportionate way to do that reduction.
It's just the calculation for getting the moment, basically, right?
Yes, and reducing it so that you're not, so that it tells you, what, it's not pulling you straight out, it's down like this.
Yeah. In the inverse, almost, is what you're looking for, almost. Right, because if 88.9, that's basically 90 degrees, you don't want your torque based on that, you want your torque based on almost the exact opposite of that, in a way. You want it based on 1.9, you're essentially only,
I don't understand.
So, just an example, like let's say this question, you're going to give us r theta, or length, or lambda in this case, if that was it, or?
No, I'm going to give you height, mass, load, xy coordinates.
I forgot, yeah, you showed that to Zahara, and I remember.
With the coordinates you can solve to get your theta, or
yes.
The tangent.
Yes. So, now let's go into segment 3. Segment 3 is head and trunk. Okay. Segment 3 is head and trunk. This is the hip, that's the shoulder. Record better. Theta 3 bends slightly forward, right? So theta 3 now is minus 79.1 degrees. That's because it's above the horizontal. Don't get bent out of shape because it's negative. It's supposed to be. It's just, if it's below the horizontal, it's positive. If it's above the horizontal, it's negative. Okay, the way we're calculating it. You can make a correction for that, but it doesn't matter.
If 79 degrees, because we're going the opposite direction to 79. Yeah. If 79 degrees positive would have been this way going this
so
way.
So 79 degrees positive would be down like this. Yeah.
Okay. You're just gonna give us these angles for
no?
Oh, we're using
tangent.
Tangent to get them. Okay. Mm-hmm. That's a good check then. If it's negative and it's not head and neck, then it's kind of like,
right.
That ain't right.
Probably, unless somebody's holding something above their head.
Okay, yeah.
You can add 360 to that. And
yes, there's all sorts of things you can do with
you
it.
You will
it's
get the exact same answer.
Yes. Yeah. There's all sorts of things you can do with this. Let's just keep it simple and do it this way, because it will give you the right answer. Okay. Forces. Okay, shoulder, equal and opposite. So now, FS prime, and because the force of the shoulder, we just calculated to be 83.3 newtons. So that's 83.3 newtons. Center of mass, we'll call that F3, is equal to which we calculated already.
465.1?
Is 465.1 newtons, yes. I need my exercise, so I'll keep walking back and forth.
So it's easy in this case. You don't even, you have the previous numbers.
That's right, that's right. This is the unknown. The force at the hip. Let's talk about our moments now. So we have the moment at the shoulder translated. That's clockwise. So the moment at the shoulder is going to be counterclockwise, ms prime. This is going to be mfs prime. This is the moment at the center of mass, m3. And then the reactive moment is clockwise, the hip. And we will stop at the hip. We'll be glad to hear.
Oh, we're not going to lower.
Not going to go below the hip. No.
Savannah.
Can you explain again, just briefly, why we have two moments at the trochanter?
Yes. The moments are at the shoulder.
Oh, the shoulder. Okay. Yeah. I was nervous. I heard hips. So.
Yeah, yeah. Let's go back here. This is the first segment. So all we have is a reactive moment. When we translate that moment here, it has an equal and opposite. However, we also translate a force, which generates its own moment.
Okay, so.
So then for the shoulder, we have this reactive moment. That reactive moment, I wanted to put squared, it's supposed to be. That reactive moment has an equal and opposite, plus the force at the shoulder has its own moment associated with it. And the center of mass has its own moment, and an equal and opposite moment at the hip. Does that help?
I just missed that one part there where you're talking about up here. You said the shoulder has its own moment, correct?
The shoulder has, it translates, the moment at the shoulder is, the reactive moment at the shoulder is translated, but the translated force has its own moment associated with it, so that's why there's two.
That's why, because the max is because we broke it up here, right?
That's right, because
we're breaking the two moments.
In typical static analysis, if you're doing engineering, most of the time you don't care what these intermediate values are. You just go all the way to the end.
Yeah.
But we do care, because we want to know specifically what the moments are at each of the joints. That's important in occupational biomechanics. Okay. So now we have L3. And somebody tell me what L3 is. I kind of want the metaphor.
It's
48.4 centimeters.
Yeah.
And lambda 3
is 30.3 centimeters.
Now, so we've got our moments, we got our angle, we got our forces, we got our lengths. We're ready to write our equations. Summation of the forces in the y direction equal to zero. Okay, so I'll cut to the chase. Force at the hip is equal to Fs prime plus F3. And if anybody needs clarification, let me know. That's 465.1 newtons. Actually,
no, you got 548.4 newtons.
Well, that's my final product. This is. I'm writing the segments down. So, for the shoulder.
Right. Oh, yeah, that's right.
For the shoulder is 83. My handwriting gets progressively worse. 83.3 newtons plus 465.1 newtons. And the final answer is? 548.4 newtons. So that's the force at the hip. Okay. Now, I'll go over here just because I can. We have the summation of the moments is equal to zero. Okay. So we'll do it mechanically. Zero equals, this is This is negative because it's counterclockwise. Counterclockwise. Negative ms prime. Negative mfs prime. Negative m3. Positive mh. So that means that mh is equal to ms prime plus mfs prime plus m3. Okay? Ms prime. We know what that is. We just calculated it over here. Moment of the shoulder, 2176.7. And I'll write the, that's Newton centimeters, I'll write the units above it. Plus cosine theta 3 times L3 times FS prime plus cosine theta 3 times lambda 3 times F3. So the values 76.7 plus what's cosine of theta 3, which is negative 79.1.
Oh,
he wants to do math. Yes, just calculator, that's all.
It's 0.189.
0.189, okay. 0.1. I'll call it just 0.19. 0.19 times L3, which is 48.4. And that's centimeters. Times FS prime, which is 83.3 newtons. Plus 0.19 cosine of theta 1 times lambda 3, 34.3. Centimeters times F3, which we already know is 465.1 newtons. And the final answer is 55. That's hard to see from back here. Why don't you guys yell at me? 5599.1. Newton centimeters.
So we, our first one over there is R forearm right here, correct? And the second part is from the elbow up, and then
This is the first part is all the way is from the your fingertip all the way or from your fist really to your elbow.
Okay.
This one is from your elbow to your shoulder.
Mm-hmm.
This one is from your shoulder to your hip is where the measurement is, but it takes into account your head as well.
Okay, that's what I was going to say.
Okay.
And these are the three segments we're going to do.
That's right.
Okay, so if you can kind of memorize these diagrams as far as what the moments and look.
I'd rather see you understand it and memorize it.
Okay.
Whatever works best.
So
I can't make you do anything.
So on the exam, you're going to give us same segment.
That's all I asked.
These three segments, but they can be configured in any way.
So it won't be. So upper arm, head. There won't be anything on the hip or.
It won't be anything below the hip.
Okay, there won't be anything below the hip.
Yeah,
so it's from head to
no
trunk.
No thigh or calf.
It's from head to trunk to about hip.
Mm-hmm. Do you have a question, Jared?
Yeah, I'm just curious if you'd ever find the torque anywhere along the segment. The center of mass.
Actually, the center of mass. There's a simplifying assumption. If you really want to do this accurately, you integrate the mass along its length. You'd have to use integrals to have the, because it starts here, but then it gets greater, progressively greater as it goes to the elbow. And you have to use either summation of very small segments or else an integral across the length. So this is a simplifying assumption that we usually do to make it easier to do. Did it answer your question?
Yeah.
Yes.
When I'm looking at the links, I notice on the other ones it goes from the dot, which is the terminal point of the structure, right? Like the. But on this one, is it really going from the top of the force on the first one?
No, it's going from the shoulder.
Okay.
Yeah,
those lines looked a little different
than
the first
one. These dots at the end of the segments represent actual locations.
Mm-hmm.
Here, this represents an actual location, but it's not the end of the segment. This
is
the shoulder.
Okay.
So when we do our test, that would be just from, this one is, it's the one that's here down to here.
Yeah, it's from your shoulder to your hip, but it takes the mass of your head into account. And generating the torque.
Okay.
So does that mean that the angle we're getting now is where our lats are, or how? What exactly is that angle?
The angle is, if I'm bent forward like that, it's this angle between the horizontal and my torso.
Okay.
That's what that theta 3 represents.
Okay, that helps.
So like on an exam, you would ask us You want to tell us which moments you're looking for or which forces you're looking for?
I'm going to ask you what the force at the elbow, the moment at the elbow, the force at the shoulder, the moment at the shoulder, the force at the hip, the moment at the hip.
Okay, you're looking for.
That's what I'm looking for.
And the
angles. Whether I explicitly ask you for angles or not, you can't do this without finding.
Okay.
So you have to do all this when I ask you a question. Yes. That's why it's half the exam. With practice, you should be able to do this in about 30 to 40 minutes. Right? And I think it's half the exam, that's reasonable.
Can you talk one more time about the M sub S prime and the M sub S prime?
Sure.
I guess to broaden the question, I'm trying to understand why it's on this segment versus the other two segments.
Yes. Well, this the only segment that you don't run into that is the first segment.
First segment.
Yeah. Because once you go from the first segment to the second segment, you have to translate two things, static moment and static force. So when I translate the static moment, that's ME prime. When I translate the static force, it's FE prime. But that generates its own moment. So that's MFE prime.
Got it.
Okay.
So that ME and that ME are the same one,
yes.
Correct? It's just carrying.
It's the same value.
And so MS, same as the MS.
MS.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So we did the elbow, the shoulder, and then the head and trunk, which
right.
was that little segment that we had to.
Right. Right. Head and trunk. It's not a little segment, it's a big one.
The one that we have to subtract to get the.
Yes. Let me finish this because there's not that much more left. The way that I see this happening, I'll finish this. You guys can take a break. Come back and I'll talk more about the project. I'll talk more about the project. Then what I'm going to do is talk about the applied physiology. And like I said, it might look intimidating, but it's really not. It's just tedious. That's all there is to it. It has big equations. And you'll have all of those right in front of you, so plug and chuck. And then, if there's any more time left today, I'll do another one of these problems. If there's not time left today, what I want you to do is to take the practice problem set and do it for next week, because I will do all of them next week. Both the applied physiology and all the biomechanics problems, okay? All right, so let me finish this, and we don't have a lot left, and then we can take a break.
Internal forces,
this is, I just want you to know that if you have access to a cadaver, for instance, you can calculate. What we've been doing is what are called external inverse kinematics, where we're starting at the load and calculating the forces all, as we make inferences about an externally defined pin-centered model. What's actually going on, and the internal forces are more accurate, is that we have the, this is for instance, this is a biceps, for example, and here we have the distal humerus, the ulna, and the radius. and the muscle is producing a force of some value, right? And what kind of, and remember what I said about levers? I talked about levers with you guys, right? First, second, and third class levers. This is a good example. The third class, I mean, extremely inefficient third class lever. Because here's the fulcrum, here's the force, and now here's the load. And that's why curls are hard to do, because that's probably one of the least efficient muscles in the body. It's a third class lever that has the force applied very close to the fulcrum. So we have the reactive force at the distal humerus. We have a distance between the force application. We have distance to the center of mass and distance to the load. Okay. The way you would think about it is that we have distance to the load, weight is the sum ratio of the moments. It's 90 degrees, so we're not going to talk about cosine, because I just want to illustrate this. So this is the distance to the load times the weight of the load in newtons, distance to the forearm and hand, center of mass, times the weight of the forearm and hand, and distance to the muscle, which internally, because we're cutting up a cadaver, we know is 5 centimeters. Right? But we don't know what muscle force is required, but we know everything else. So therefore, you can calculate at that, in that kind of a condition, how much force the muscle would be required to generate in order to hold that. 346 newtons to hold a 49 newton mass.
Wow.
Or load. That's why, like I say, curls are hard, and that's why they're hard. And it has to, you have to generate multiple times the amount of force than the load that you're holding. Or moments, I'm sorry. And I think that this is a, oh no, no, that's right, because everything is known except for the new force.
About and five, dm, is that from the center of the mass, that center to the elbow?
This is the distance from the elbow, the distal humerus, to the insertion.
That's 5 centimeters.
Mm-hmm, it's 5 centimeters. So we know everything except that the force exertion. And then you go on and generate and calculate forces so that you get the reactive force at the elbow. Okay. But this is the part that I think is the most instructive right here. How much force a muscle has to generate to lift a 49 newton load? It's a lot.
Are you going to ask us about internal forces?
I think you have enough to occupy yourself.
Well, I appreciate that.
I wouldn't ask you to calculate it. I might ask you to talk about it, but I wouldn't ask you to calculate it.
So like a conceptual.
Mm-hmm. Just to give you some other ideas of other ways that biomechanics is calculated is the L5 and S1 segment and also L4, L5 are biomechanically vulnerable segments. So there's a lot of effort that goes into lower back models, okay? And this is just an example of how we might want to divide the greater trochanter, a marker on the lower back, not necessarily a bone screw, and then another marker on the shoulder. Once again, that gives us a little bit more resolution in modeling the lower back. Yet another one is to incorporate intra-abdominal force. What do you do when you lift? You hold your breath and you press down in your stomach. Your stomach is like a balloon, right? Your abdomen is like a balloon. What you're doing is you're creating in both the thoracic cavity and the abdominal cavity this omnidirectional upward directed force that actually creates a lot of resistance to shear and compression on your back. So somebody decided that, okay, we can model that by including what the intra-abdominal force is. One of the problems is measuring it. Okay? living subjects, and I won't be too graphic, but there's two directions you can measure intra-abdominal force from. Neither of them are very pleasant, okay? The one that we did in a lab that I was in, and I tried it, was a nasogastric catheter. And so what you do is you spray this lidocaine up your nose and in the back of your throat. You take this little wire, stick it up there, and eventually you can swallow it. Just keep swallowing.
Oh, yeah.
And after a while, it's really not irritating until maybe about 30 or 40 minutes, then you want to get rid of it. But that's a good way to measure it because it has a transducer on the end, and it's easy to sterilize. There was another genius, and I can't remember who the company was, I just got to tell you this, it's one of my favorite stories. They said, you know, it's so hard to put, you know, either, and by the way, the other direction is called a rectal balloon. And so you can imagine how unpleasant that is. Somebody said, the nasogastric catheter and rectal balloons are so unpleasant, why don't we give them a pill to swallow with a radio transmitter on it? Sounds like a great idea, except for some reason, they decided that it wasn't disposable. So we have this retrieval and reuse problem. Nobody wanted to be the second person to use the thing, so they might as well have made it disposable. They didn't catch on, by the way, for some odd reason. So intra-abdominal pressure is very useful, it's just difficult to measure. And then this is an example. I told you about the guy at the University of Michigan that does cadaver hands. And this is an example of the extent of his modeling. Instead of doing the elbow angle, the shoulder angle, he does the angle between the first and second, or the middle and the proximal phalanx, and the angle between the proximal phalanx and the metacarpal. And then he calculates forces. This is the extensor digiti carpi, the flexor digitorum profundus, flexor digitorum superficialis. This is the metacarpal phalangeo, the proximal interphalangeo, distal interphalangeo, and the tip. So he has all these angles, his four angles, just from the metacarpal all the way to the tip of the hand. It is that level of modeling. Like I said, if you remember, the more segments you have, the more resolution you have. A pin center joint is not too bad. There, it's not too bad an assumption because our fingers are stiff. I mean, each of the segments, each phalanx is stiff. And so this is an example of the type of the detail of modeling that is done sometimes with the hand. All right. You guys deserve a break, so why don't you come back at 20 of, it's a little in excess of 15 minutes, and then we'll plow on to the end.